The 1960s was a tumultuous time, often characterized by the Civil Rights Movement, Vietnam War, and a rapidly changing United States. However, the 1960s was also a time of economic strength for the city of Atlanta's corporate sector. But a conflict in 1964 would test Atlanta's leaders' will for economic success. Under close observation of most of the world, Atlanta would have to choose between the image of equality or racial injustice, and deal with the economic consequences of its decision. Out of this confrontation, a compromise willed by Coca-Cola Industries urged the city of Atlanta to confront its racial identity and force the corporate sector to establish its role in the fight for racial equality. The Civil Rights Movement was a time of great struggle and achievement, anger and joyfulness, harsh conflict, and remarkable compromise. As a result of the Civil Rights Movement, the United States transformed not into an unrealistic racial utopia, but into a nation self-aware of its past and present, and willing, albeit reluctantly, to pursue a better future for all Americans. But America did not change overnight. It took the persistent struggles of not only big names like Martin Luther King Jr., Malcolm X, and Rosa Parks, but also of the common fighter fixed on racial equality and a better American future to truly give the Civil Rights Movement life. However, the common representation of sit-ins, marches, and court cases does not completely encapsulate the Civil Rights Movement. Out of public view was a constant economic struggle between white business elites and civil rights activists. Throughout America, clashes over racial equality in the business sector begat confrontation and even violence. But the city of Atlanta, described by W.B. Du Bois as a city too southern for the north and too northern for the south, was an example of racial compromise in the 1960s business sector. In Atlanta, the business elite worked with the local activists to celebrate the recent accomplishments of civil rights leader Martin Luther King Jr. The persistent effort of civil rights activists, Coca-Cola Industries, Atlanta Mayor Ivan Allen Jr., and many proud American citizens created an unprecedented compromise between Atlanta business and racial progressives in the 1960s. The multicultural dinner by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. at the Dinkler Plaza Hotel represented a monumental compromise between the high, middle, and lower classes in Atlanta, Georgia.
The mayor, Ivan Allen, was very concerned about how the city was perceived by the rest of the country, wanted to honor him, felt it was necessary to honor him. And it really took Coca-Cola to make the difference because initially there wasn't much response to the concept of having a dinner for him.
On December 10th, 1964, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in Oslo, Norway. Dr. King played a monumental role in leading and organizing the Southern Civil Rights Movement till this point. From the Children's March to the Civil Disobedience Campaign, Dr. King had led a peaceful yet powerful movement, prioritizing continued effort over violent riots. Dr. King's ability to capture the gaze of America through peace in the face of adversity and fiery, uplifting speeches made him the ideal candidate for the Nobel Prize. During his acceptance speech, Dr. King spoke of the continued struggle of millions of African Americans, while expressing his assurance for a better future.
I believe that even amid today's mortar bursts and whining bullets, there is still hope for a brighter tomorrow. I believe that wounded justice, lying prostrate on the blood-flowing streets of our nations, can be lifted from this dust of shame to reign supreme among the children of men.
While Dr. King was being praised for his peaceful organizations of civil disobedience in Norway, across the Atlantic, Dr. King's supporters were diligently organizing a celebration for the first Georgian recipient of the Nobel Prize. However, this would prove more difficult than originally imagined. Back in Dr. King's hometown, Atlanta Mayor Ivan Allen Jr. was strenuously pushing to label Atlanta as too economically focused to succumb to racial tensions and cultural stereotypes. While racism existed in Atlanta, the city was continuously pushing for international businesses, and thus exhibited a greater than racism ambiance. Previously, Mayor Allen had transformed the city in subtle ways, from removing the whites-only signs at City Hall and sitting with black lawyers and doctors. Mr. Allen was truly embracing racial equality for the economic success of Atlanta. This passion propelled Mr. Allen to rally support for Dr. King's celebration dinner. Having a multicultural celebration for the Georgian Nobel laureate would send a clear message to international businesses that Atlanta stood above the racist imperfections of most of the South. So Mayor Allen sent out invitations to Atlanta's political, religious, business, and intellectual leaders of all races. The response was not strong.
So Paul Austin, the president of the company, and Mayor Ivan Allen traveled to Itchaway to say the New York Times has written a damning piece about about the city of Atlanta. New York Times has written a negative piece about the city of Atlanta not honoring Dr. King. So Robert Woodruff said, go back, pull the civic leaders together, and tell them that it's important to Coke that he be honored. Ticket sales hadn't been moving at all. The dinner wasn't going to be very successful. So Paul Austin, who was president of Coca-Cola in South Africa and had seen apartheid firsthand, knew that that couldn't exist in Atlanta.
Mayor Allen worried that the event would show Atlanta's racial weaknesses to international companies, decided to enlist the help of former Coca-Cola chairman Robert Woodruff, arguably the most powerful man in Atlanta at the time. While Woodruff was definitely not a progressive, he was business savvy. He understood that Atlanta would have to ascend above the pettiness and racism if Atlanta were to ever become an international city. Accordingly, he directed Mayor Allen to the acting Coca-Cola president, J. Paul Austin.
Paul Austin came here from South Africa. He'd been in South Africa for 14 years. He had been struggling with a race question. He was in South Africa when apartheid was born. But Afrikaners was put over from the British. And he saw a society deteriorating in the racial segregation. And when he came to Atlanta, I would say as much as any single person, and the Coca-Cola company, I just couldn't afford to be in a town of bad racial.
So J. Paul Austin, accompanied by Mayor Allen, gathered all of Atlanta's leaders at the Piedmont Driving Club. It was here that he said, "It is embarrassing for Coca-Cola to be located in a city that refuses to honor its Nobel Prize winner. We are an international business. The Coca-Cola Company does not need Atlanta. You all have to decide whether Atlanta needs the Coca-Cola Company." The event was sold out in 2 hours. On January 27th, 1965, over 1,500 business owners, politicians, and religious leaders packed La Dinkler Plaza Hotel to honor Dr. King and financially support his nonviolent movement. The business elite of Atlanta had successfully compromised with Atlanta's activists and community leaders to celebrate Dr. King and display Atlanta's ability to overcome racial boundaries and stand united. However, the dinner also represented a vital part of the civil rights effort that is often overlooked. The economic battle waged by Mayor Allen and Coca-Cola Industries against the business leaders of Atlanta exemplified the common strategy of civil rights activists to use institutions' financial incentives to enact social change. Neither Mayor Allen nor Coca-Cola executives could tolerate Atlanta being characterized as racist like other U.S. cities. So, not an act of social justice, but instead of economic protection, Atlanta elites and corresponding institutions were forced to embrace racial equality. From Coca-Cola's stand in Atlanta to Dr. King's Montgomery bus boycotts, economics has often been an instrument for social change. Racism was an expensive ideology to maintain, and the acts of brave fighters for equality made it even more financially senseless. Atlanta's business leaders refused to allow racism to dampen its business potential, but instead used the same business mindset to force social change and solidify itself as truly the city too busy to hate.